Hecate. Hecate or Hecate, Hecate, is a goddess in ancient Greek religion and mythology, most often shown holding a pair of torches or a key and in later periods depicted in triple form. She was variously associated with crossroads, entrance ways, light, magic, witchcraft, knowledge of herbs and poisonous plants, ghosts, necromancy, and sorcery. She appears in the Homeric Hymn to Demeter and in Hesiod's Theogony, where she is promoted strongly as a great goddess. The place of origin of her following is uncertain, but it is thought that she had popular followings in Thrace. Hecate was one of the main deities worshipped in Athenian households as a protective goddess and one who bestowed prosperity and daily blessings on the family. In the post-Christian writings of the Chaldean Oracles, 2nd-3rd century CE, she was regarded with, some, rulership over earth, sea, and sky, as well as a more universal role as Saviour, Soteira, mother of angels and the cosmic world soul. Regarding the nature of her cult, it has been remarked, she is more at home on the fringes than in the center of Greek polytheism. Intrinsically ambivalent and polymorphous, she straddles conventional boundaries and eludes definition. The etymology of the name Hecate, capital Eta, Hecate, is not known. Some suggestions derive the name from a Greek root, from kappa nu willing, thus, she who works her will or similar, or from kappa alpha tau sigma Hekatos, an obscure epithet of Apollo interpreted as the far-reaching one or the far-darter, whence for the feminine form she that operates from afar or she that removes or drives off. R.S.P. Beeks rejected a Greek etymology and suggested a pre-Greek origin. A possibility for foreign origin of the name may be Hecate, name of an Egyptian goddess of fertility and childbirth. In early modern English, the name was also pronounced disyllabically, as, and sometimes spelled Hecate. It remained common practice in English to pronounce her name in two syllables, even when spelled with final E, well into the 19th century. The spelling Hecate is due to Arthur Golding's 1567 translation of Ovid's Metamorphoses, and this spelling without the final E later appears in plays of the Elizabethan Jacobean period. Webster's Dictionary of 1866 particularly credits the influence of Shakespeare for the then predominant disyllabic pronunciation of the name. Hecate possibly originated among the Carians of Anatolia, the region where most Theophoric names invoking Hecate, such as Hecateus or Hecatumnus, the father of Mausolus, are attested, and where Hecate remained a great goddess into historical times, at her unrivaled cult site in Lagina. While many researchers favor the idea that she has Anatolian origins, it has been argued that Hecate must have been a Greek goddess. The monuments to Hecate in Phrygia and Caria are numerous but of late date. William Berg observes, since children are not called after spooks, it is safe to assume that Carian Theophoric names involving Hecate refer to a major deity free from the dark and unsavory ties to the underworld and to witchcraft associated with the Hecate of classical Athens. In particular, there is some evidence that she might be derived from the local sun goddesses, see also Erina, based on similar attributes. If Hecate's cult spread from Anatolia into Greece, it is possible it presented a conflict, as her role was already filled by other more prominent deities in the Greek pantheon, above all by Artemis and Selene. This line of reasoning lies behind the widely accepted hypothesis that she was a foreign deity who was incorporated into the Greek pantheon. Other than in the Theogony, the Greek sources do not offer a consistent story of her parentage, or of her relations in the Greek pantheon. Sometimes Hecate is related as a chitoness, and a mighty helper and protector of humans. Shrines to Hecate were placed at doorways to both homes and cities with the belief that it would protect from restless dead and other spirits. Likewise, shrines to Hecate at three-way crossroads were created where food offerings were left at the new moon to protect those who did so from spirits and other evils. Dogs were sacred to Hecate and associated with roads, domestic spaces, purification, and spirits of the dead. Dogs were also sacrificed to the road. This can be compared to Pausanias' report that in the Ionian city of Colophon in Asia Minor a sacrifice of a black female puppy was made to Hecate as the wayside goddess, and Plutarch's observation that in Boeotia dogs were killed in purificatory rites. Dogs, with puppies often mentioned, were offered to Hecate at crossroads, which were sacred to the goddess. Hecate was a popular divinity, and her cult was practiced with many local variations all over Greece and western Anatolia. However, she did not have many known sanctuaries or temples dedicated to her aside from her most famous temple in Lagina. There was a temple of Hecate in Argolis, over against the sanctuary of Eleithaia is a temple of Hecate, the goddess probably here identified with the apotheos Iphigenia, and the image is a work of Scopas. This one is of stone, while the bronze images opposite, also of Hecate, were made respectively by Polycletos and his brother Naucides. There were also a shrine to Hecate in Aegina, where she was very popular. Aside from her own temples, Hecate was also worshipped in the sanctuaries of other gods, where she was apparently sometimes given her own space. There was an area sacred to Hecate in the precincts of the Temple of Artemis at Ephesus, where the priests, Megabyzae, officiated. This sanctuary was called Hecatesian, Shrine of Hecate. Hecate was also worshipped in the Temple of Athena in Titan. In Titan there is also a sanctuary of Athena, into which they bring up the image of Coronis, mother of Asclepius. The sanctuary is built upon a hill, at the bottom of which is an altar of the winds, and on it the priest sacrifices to the winds one night in every year. He also performs other secret rites, of Hecate, at four pits, taming the fierceness of blasts, of the winds, and he is said to chant as well the charms of Medea. She was most commonly worshipped in nature, where she had many natural sanctuaries. An important sanctuary of Hecate was a holy cave on the island of Samothrake called Zerinthos. Hecate's most important sanctuary was Lagina, a theocratic city-state in which the goddess was served by eunuchs. The temple is mentioned by Strabo. Lagina, where the famous temple of Hecate drew great festal assemblies every year, lay close to the originally Macedonian colony of Stratonikea, where she was the city's patron. In Thrace she played a role similar to that of Lesser Hermes, namely a ruler of liminal regions, particularly Gates, and the wilderness. Hecate was greatly worshipped in Byzantium. She was said to have saved the city from Philip II, warning the citizens of a nighttime attack by a light in Thespi, for which she was known as Hecate Lampadephoros. The tale is preserved in the Suda. As Hecate Phosphorus, Venus, she is said to have lit the sky during the siege of Philip II in 340, revealing the attack to its inhabitants. The Byzantines dedicated a statue to her as the lamp carrier. The Athenian Greeks honored Hecate during the Diapnon. In Greek, Diapnon means the evening meal, usually the largest meal of the day. Hecate's Diapnon is, at its most basic, a meal served to Hecate and the restless dead once a lunar month during the new moon. The Diapnon is always followed the next day by the new menia, when the first sliver of moon is visible, and then the Agathos Daimon the day after that. The main purpose of the Diapnon was to honor Hecate and to placate the souls in her wake who longed for vengeance. A secondary purpose was to purify the household and to atone for bad deeds a household member may have committed that offended Hecate, causing her to withhold her favor from them. The Diapnon consists of three main parts: 1. The meal that was set out at a crossroads, usually in a shrine outside the entryway to the home; 2. An expiation sacrifice; and 3. Purification of the household. Hecate was known by a number of bynames. Hecate was generally represented as three-formed. This has been speculated as being connected with the appearance of the full moon, half moon, and new moon. As a virgin goddess, she remained unmarried and had no regular consort, though some traditions named her as the mother of Scylla. The earliest Greek depictions of Hecate were not three-formed. Farnell states, "The evidence of the monuments as to the character and significance of Hecate is almost as full as that of to express her manifold and mystic nature." The earliest known monument is a small terracotta found in Athens, with a dedication to Hecate, in writing of the style of the 6th century. The goddess is seated on a throne with a chaplet bound round her head. She is altogether without attributes and character, and the main historical value of Hecate's work, which is evidently of quite a general type and gets a special reference and name merely from the inscription, is that it proves the single shape to bear earlier form, and her recognition at Athens to be earlier than the Persian invasion. The 2nd century travel writer Pausanias stated that Hecate was first depicted in triplicate by the sculptor Alcamenes in the Greek classical period of the late 5th century BCE, which was placed before the Temple of the Wingless Nike in Athens. Greek anthropomorphic conventions of art resisted representing her with three faces. A votive sculpture from Attica of the 3rd century BCE, illustration, left, shows three single images against a column, round the column of Hecate and Sacerates. Some classical portrayals show her as a triplicate goddess holding a torch, a key, serpents, daggers and numerous other items. Depictions of both a single form Hecate and triple formed, as well as occasional four-headed descriptions continued throughout her history. In Egyptian-inspired Greek esoteric writings connected with Hermes Trismegistus, and in magical papyri of late antiquity she is described as having three heads, one dog, one serpent, and one horse. In other representations her animal heads include those of a cow and a boar. Hecate's triplicity is elsewhere expressed in a more Hellenic fashion in the vast frieze of the Great Pergamon Altar, now in Berlin, wherein she is shown with three bodies, taking part in the battle with the Titans. In the Arglid, near the shrine of the Dioscuri, Pausanias saw the temple of Hecate opposite the sanctuary of Ilithyia. He reported the image to be the work of Scopas, stating further, "This one is of stone, while the bronze images opposite, also of Hecate, were made respectively by Polyclitus and his brother Nausides, son of Mothan." Description of Greece 2.22.7. In the Argonautica, a 3rd century BCE Alexandrian epic based on early material, Jason placates Hecate in a ritual prescribed by Medea, her priestess, bathed at midnight in a stream of flowing water, and dressed in dark robes. Jason is to dig a round pit and over it cut the throat of an ewe, sacrificing it and then burning it whole on a pyre next to the pit as a holocaust. He is told to sweeten the offering with a libation of honey, then to retreat from the site without looking back, even if he hears the sound of footsteps or barking dogs. All these elements betoken the rites owed to Athena deity. A 4th century BCE marble relief from Crannon in Thessaly was dedicated by a racehorse owner. It shows Hecate, with a hound beside her, placing a wreath on the head of a mare. She is commonly attended by a dog or dogs, and the most common form of offering was to leave meat at a crossroads. Images of her attended by a dog are also found at times when she is shown as in her role as mother goddess with child, and when she is depicted alongside the god Hermes and the goddess Cybele in reliefs. Dogs were closely associated with Hecate in the classical world. In art and in literature, Hecate is constantly represented as dog-shaped or as accompanied by a dog. Her approach was heralded by the howling of a dog. The dog was Hecate's regular sacrificial animal, and was often eaten in solemn sacrament. The sacrifice of dogs to Hecate is attested for Thrace, Samothrace, Colophon, and Athens. It has been claimed that her association with dogs is suggestive of her connection with birth, for the dog was sacred to Ilithyia, Genetilis, and other birth goddesses. Although in later times Hecate's dog came to be thought of as a manifestation of restless souls or demons who accompanied her, its docile appearance and its accompaniment of a Hecate who looks completely friendly in many pieces of ancient art suggests that its original signification was positive and thus likelier to have arisen from the dog's connection with birth than the dog's underworld associations. The association with dogs, particularly female dogs, could be explained by a metamorphosis myth in Lycophron. The friendly-looking female dog accompanying Hecate was originally the Trojan queen Hecabe, who leapt into the sea after the fall of Troy and was transformed by Hecate into her familiar. Another metamorphosis myth explains why the polecat is also associated with Hecate. From Antoninus Liberalis, at Thebes Proedos had a daughter Galanthias. This maiden was playmate and companion of Alcmene, daughter of Electrion. As the birth throes for Heracles were pressing on Alcmene, the Moirai, Fates, and Ilithyia, birth goddess, as a favor to Hera, kept Alcmene in continuous birth pangs. They remained seated, each keeping their arms crossed. Galanthias, fearing that the pains of her labor would drive Alcmene mad, ran to the Moirai and Ilithyia and announced that by desire of Zeus a boy had been born to Alcmene and that their prerogatives had been abolished. At all this, consternation of course overcame the Moirai and they immediately let go their arms. Alcmene's pangs ceased at once and Heracles was born. The Moirai were aggrieved at this and took away the womanly parts of Galanthias since, being but a mortal, she had deceived the gods. They turned her into a deceitful weasel, or polecat, making her live in crannies and gave her a grotesque way of mating. She is mounted through the ears and gives birth by bringing forth her young through the throat. Hecate felt sorry for this transformation of her appearance and appointed her a sacred servant of herself. Ilion told a different story of a woman transformed into a polecat. "I have heard that the polecat was once a human being. It has also reached my hearing that Gale was her name then, that she was a dealer in spells and a sorceress, pharmakes, that she was extremely incontinent, and that she was afflicted with abnormal sexual desires. Nor has it escaped my notice that the anger of the goddess Hecate transformed it into this evil creature. May the goddess be gracious to me, fables in their telling I leave to others." Athenaeus of Naucratis, drawing on the entomological speculation of Apollodorus of Athens, notes that the red mullet is sacred to Hecate, on account of the resemblance of their names, for that the goddess is trimorphos, of a triple form. The Greek word for mullet was trigal and later trigala. He goes on to quote a fragment of verse, "O mistress Hecate, Trioditis, with three forms and three faces, propitiated with mullets." In relation to Greek concepts of pollution, Parker observes, The fish that was most commonly banned was the red mullet, trigal, which fits neatly in taffy pattern. It delighted in polluted things, and would eat the corpse of a fish or a man. Blood-colored itself, it was sacred to the blood-eating goddess Hecate. It seems a symbolic summation of all the negative characteristics of the creatures of the deep. At Athens, it is said there stood a statue of Hecate Triglathena, to whom the red mullet was offered in sacrifice. After mentioning that this fish was sacred to Hecate, Alan Davidson writes, Cicero, Horace, Juvenal, Martial, Pliny, Seneca and Suetonius have left abundant and interesting testimony to the red mullet fever, which began to affect wealthy Romans during the last years of the Republic and really gripped them in the early empire. The main symptoms were a preoccupation with size, the consequent rise to absurd heights of the prices of large specimens, a habit of keeping red mullet in captivity, and the enjoyment of the highly specialized aesthetic experience induced by watching the color of the dying fish change. The frog, which was also the symbol of the similarly named Egyptian goddess Hecate, has also become sacred to Hecate in modern pagan literature, possibly due in part to its ability to cross between two elements. In her three-headed representations, discussed above, Hecate often has one or more animal heads, including cow, dog, boar, serpent and horse. Hecate was closely associated with plant lore and the concoction of medicines and poisons. In particular, she was thought to give instruction in these closely related arts. Apollonius of Rhodes, in the Archaeonautica, mentions that Medea was taught by Hecate. I have mentioned to you before a certain young girl whom Hecate, daughter of Perses, has taught to work in drugs. The goddess is described as wearing oaken fragments of Sophocles' Lost Play, The Root Diggers, or The Root Cutters, and an ancient commentary on Apollonius of Rhodes' Archaeonautica, 3.1214. Describes her as having a head surrounded by serpents, twining through branches of oak. The yew in particular was sacred to Hecate. Hecate was said to favor offerings of garlic, which was closely associated with her cult. She is also sometimes associated with Cyprus, a tree symbolic of death in the underworld, and hence sacred to a number of faunic deities. A number of other plants, often poisonous, medicinal and/or psychoactive, are associated with Hecate. These include aconite, also called hecatice, belladonna, dittany, and mandrake. It has been suggested that the use of dogs for digging up mandrake is further corroboration of the association of this plant with Hecate. Indeed, since at least as early as the 1st century CE, there are a number of attestations to the apparently widespread practice of using dogs to dig up plants associated with magic. Hecate was associated with borders, city walls, doorways, crossroads and, by extension, with realms outside or beyond the world of the living. She appears to have been particularly associated with being between and hence is frequently characterized as a liminal goddess. Hecate mediated between regimes, Olympian and Titan, but also between mortal and divine spheres. This liminal role is reflected in a number of her cult titles, Apotropaia, that turns away slash protects, Enodia, on the way, Propalia, Propalia, before the gate, Triodia, Trioditis, who frequents crossroads, Clydeuchos, holding the keys, etc. This function would appear to have some relationship with the iconographic association of Hecate with keys, and might also relate to her appearance with two torches, which when positioned on either side of a gate or door illuminated the immediate area and allowed visitors to be identified. In Byzantium, small temples in her honor were placed close to the gates of the city. Hecate's importance to Byzantium was above all as a deity of protection. When Philip of Macedon was about to attack the city, according to the legend, she alerted the townspeople with her ever-present torches, and with her pack of dogs, which served as her constant companions. This suggests that Hecate's close association with dogs derived in part from the use of watchdogs, who, particularly at night, raised an alarm when intruders approached. Watchdogs were used extensively by Greeks and Romans. Cult images and altars of Hecate in her triplicate or trimorphic form were placed at three-way crossroads, though they also appeared before private homes and in front of city gates. In this form she came to be identified with the Roman goddess Diana Trivia, of the three ways. In what appears to be a 7th-century indication of the survival of cult practices of this general sort, St. Eligius, in his sermon, warns the sick among his recently converted flock in Flanders against putting devilish charms at springs or trees or crossroads, and, according to St. Wen, would urge them no Christian should make or render any devotion to the deities of the Trivium, where three roads meet. Like Hecate, Tihidog is a creature of the threshold, the guardian of doors and portals, and so it is appropriately associated with the frontier between life and death, and with demons and ghosts which move across the frontier. The yawning gates of Hades were guarded by the monstrous watchdog Cerberus, whose function was to prevent the living from entering the underworld, and the dead from leaving it. Hecate has been characterized as a pre-Olympian Thonic goddess. The first literature mentioning Hecate is the Theogony by Hesiod. According to Hesiod, she held sway over many things. Hesiod emphasizes that Hecate was an only child, the daughter of Perseus and Asteria, the sister of Leto, the mother of Artemis and Apollo. Grandmother of the three cousins was Phoebe, the ancient Titaness who personified the moon. Hesiod's inclusion and praise of Hecate in the Theogony has been troublesome for scholars, in that he seems to hold her in high regard, while the testimony of other writers, and surviving evidence, suggests that this may have been the exception. One theory is that Hesiod's original village had a substantial Hecate following, and that his inclusion of her in the Theogony was a way of adding to her prestige by spreading word of her among his readers. Another theory is that Hecate was mainly a household god, and humble household worship could have been more pervasive and yet not mentioned as much as temple worship. In Athens, Hecate, along with Zeus, Hermes, Hestia, and Apollo, were very important in daily life as they were the main gods of the household. However, it is clear that the special position given to Hecate by Zeus is upheld throughout her history by depictions found on coins depicting Hecate on the hand of Zeus, as highlighted in more recent research presented by Deste and Rankin. In the Homeric Hymn to Demeter, Hecate is called the tender-hearted, a euphemism perhaps intended to emphasize her concern with the disappearance of Persephone, when she assisted Demeter with her search for Persephone following her abduction by Hades, suggesting that Demeter should speak to the god of the sun, Helios. Subsequently, she became Persephone's companion on her yearly journey to and from the realms of Hades, serving as a psychopomp. Because of this association, Hecate was one of the chief goddesses of the Eleusinian mysteries, alongside Demeter and Persephone. Variations and interpretations of Hecate's role or roles can be traced in classical Athens. In two fragments of Aeschylus, she appears as a great goddess. In Sophocles and Euripides, she is characterized as the mistress of witchcraft and the Kyries. One surviving group of stories suggests how Hecate might have come to be incorporated into the Greek pantheon without affecting the privileged position of Artemis. Here, Hecate is a mortal priestess often associated with Iphigenia. She scorns and insults Artemis, who in retribution eventually brings about the mortal's suicide. In various accounts, Hecate was described either as the daughter of, 1, Dio, Demeter, and thus half-sister of Persephone, 2, daughter of Night, 3, Zeus and Asteria, or lastly of Aristeas. Hecate is the primary feminine figure in the Chaldean Oracles, 2nd-3rd century CE, where she is associated in fragment 194 with Astrophilos, usually translated as a spinning top, or wheel, used in magic, labor thou around the Astrophilos of Hecate. This appears to refer to a variant of the device mentioned by Salus. In Hellenistic syncretism, Hecate also became closely associated with Isis. Lucius Apuleius in The Golden Ass, 2nd century, equates Juno, Bellona, Hecate and Isis in the syncretism during late antiquity of Hellenistic and late Babylonian, Chaldean, elements. Hecate was identified with Eresh-Kigal, the underworld counterpart of Inanna in the Babylonian cosmography. In the Michigan Magical Papyrus, INV 7, dated to the late 3rd or early 4th century CE, Hecate Eresh-Kigal is invoked against fear of punishment in the afterlife. Stromiska, 2005, claimed that Hecate, conflated with the figure of Diana, appears in late antiquity and in the early medieval period as part of an emerging legend complex known as the Society of Diana, associated with gatherings of women, the moon, and witchcraft that eventually became established in the area of northern Italy, southern Germany, and the western Balkans. This theory of the Roman origins of many European folk traditions related to Diana or Hecate was explicitly advanced at least as early as 1807 and is reflected in etymological claims by early modern lexicographers from the 17th to the 19th century, connecting hag, hexawitch to the name of Hecate. Such derivations are today proposed only by a minority. A medieval commentator has suggested a link connecting the word jinx with Hecate. The Byzantine polymath Michael Salus speaks of a bull-roarer, consisting of a golden sphere, decorated throughout with symbols and whirled on an oxhide thong. He adds that such an instrument is called the myunx, hence jinx, but as for the significance, says only that it is ineffable and that the ritual is sacred to Hecate. Shakespeare mentions Hecate both before the end of the 16th century, A Midsummer Night's Dream, 1594 to 96, and just after, in Macbeth, 1605, specifically, in the title character's dagger soliloquy, witchcraft celebrates pale Hecate's offerings. In 1929, Lewis Brown, an expert on religious cults, connected the 1920s Blackburn cult, also known as the Cult of the Great Eleven, with Hecate worship rituals. He noted that the cult regularly practiced dog sacrifice and had secretly buried the body of one of its queens with seven dogs. Researcher Samuel Fort noted additional parallels, to include the cult's focus on mystic and typically nocturnal rites, its female-dominated membership, the sacrifice of other animals, to include horses and mules, a focus on the mystical properties of roads and portals, and an emphasis on death, healing, and resurrection. As a goddess of witchcraft, Hecate has been incorporated in various systems of modern witchcraft, Wicca and neo-paganism, in some cases associated with the wild hunt of Germanic tradition, in others as part of a reconstruction of specifically Greek polytheism, in English also known as Hellenismos. In Wicca, Hecate has in some cases become identified with the crone aspect of the triple goddess. Hecate is also the namesake of the 100th numbered asteroid, which was discovered by American astronomer James Craig Watson on July 11, 1868. Its adopted name alludes to it as being the 100th named asteroid, Hecate being the Greek for 100. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.